And welcome back to Story Time with Winny and Nan. And tonight is a special night. Our theme is going to be animals in honor of Winston's 9th birthday. Today is his birthday, so we're celebrating tonight with Winston. The materials that you'll need to do your crafts are a paper towel roll, some peanut butter, some bird seed, and some string. And for our second craft, you'll need 2 paper plates, a plastic spoon, a Sharpie, some curly pasta, some glue, and the regular crayons and some tape. And for our third craft, you'll need a piece of black construction paper, a scissors, some colored tissue paper that you have around the house, and a black pipe cleaner. So those are the items that you can gather so you will be able to do the crafts that we're going to do after we read the books today. The first 2 books that we're going to read today are Click Clack Moo, Cows That Type, and the author of that book is Doreen Cronin. And the second book that we're going to read is The Busy Little Squirrel, and the author of that book is Nancy Tafuri. Click Clack Moo, Cows That Type by Doreen Cronin. Farmer Brown has a problem. His cows like to type. All day long he hears click clack moo, click clack moo, clickety clack moo. At first, he couldn't believe his ears. Cows that type? Impossible. Click clack moo, click clack moo, clickety clack moo. Then he couldn't believe his eyes. Dear Farmer Brown, the barn is very cold at night. We'd like some electric blankets. Sincerely, the cows. It was bad enough the cows had found the old typewriter in the barn. Now they wanted electric blankets? No way, said Farmer Brown. No electric blankets. So the cows went on strike. They left a note on the barn door. Sorry, we're closed. No milk today. No milk today? Cried Farmer Brown. In the background, he heard the cows busy at work. Click, clack, moo. Click, clack, moo. Clickety, clack, moo. The next day, he got another note. Dear Farmer Brown, the hens are cold too. They'd like electric blankets. Sincerely, the cows. The cows were growing impatient with the farmer. They left a new note on the barn door. Closed. No milk. No eggs. No eggs, cried Farmer Brown. In the background, he heard them. Click, clack, moo, click, clack, moo, clickety, clack, moo. Cows that type? Hens on strike? Whoever heard of such a thing? How can I run a farm with no milk and no eggs? Farmer Brown was furious. Farmer Brown got out his own typewriter. Dear cows and hens, there will be no electric blankets. You are cows and hens. I demand milk and eggs. Sincerely, Farmer Brown. Duck was a neutral party, so he brought the ultimatum to the cows. The cows held an emergency meeting. All the animals gathered around the barn to snoop, but none of them could understand moo. All night long, Farmer Brown waited for an answer. Duck knocked on the door early the next morning. He handed Farmer Brown a note. Dear Farmer Brown, We will exchange our typewriter for electric blankets. Leave them outside the barn door, and we will send Duck over with the typewriter. Sincerely, the cows. Farmer Brown decided this was a good deal. He left the blankets next to the barn door and waited for Duck to come with the typewriter. The next morning, he got a note. Dear Farmer Brown, the pond is quite boring. We'd like a diving board. Sincerely, the ducks. Click, clack, quack. Click, clack, quack. Clickety, clack, quack. Did they get their diving board? Yes, they did. Okay, the second book we're going to read is The Busy Little Squirrel by Nancy Tafuri. Leaves were falling. The air was getting cold. It was time for Squirrel to get ready for winter. Squeak, squeak, said Mouse. Will you nibble a pumpkin with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was so busy. Sweet, sweet, said Bird. Will you rest on a branch with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was so busy. Croak, croak, said Frog. Will you hop rocks with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was so busy. Meow, meow, said Cat. Will you lie in the snow with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was so busy. Woof, woof, said Dog. Will you run in the field with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was so busy. Hoo, 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 called Owl. Will you watch the moon with us? But Squirrel couldn't. He was fast asleep. He got all ready for winter. Okay, so the craft that we're going to do to go along with those books is we're going to make a bird feeder, and I'm going to do this inside, so I'm going to put down some newspaper so that I don't make a mess, but you can do this outside, and that way you don't have to worry about it. So what I have here is I have some bird seed, and I took a paper towel roll, and you can cut it to any size that you want. You can make it big or small, and I have some peanut butter. And what I did was, this is what we're going to end up with. I took my paper towel roll and I cut it to this size. And I took a knife and I put peanut butter all over
the towel holder. And I tied a string around so that I can hang it once I put the bird seed on it. I can hang it from a tree. And then it's very simple. You can just put this in the bird seed and take your hand and you can make the bird seed will stick to the peanut butter. And you can just put the seed right on your towel holder and it will stick. And what you end up with is something you can hang from the tree and watch the birds come and eat from your bird feeder. So enjoy making that.
The next two books we're going to read today are A Friend for Einstein, and the author of this is Charlie Cantrell and Dr. Rachel Wagner. And the next one is The Lion and the Mouse, and the author of that is Jenny Broom.
A Friend for Einstein, The Smallest Stallion, by Charlie Cantrell and Dr. Rachel Wagner. And you can tell, children, by the pictures in this book that this is a true story. Far from the loud city streets, just past the rickety rack of hard-working tractors, and behind the gates of a horse farm, there lived a little foal. His name was Einstein. He was the smallest horse ever born. He was a mini, miniature horse. And this is Einstein. Every morning, after a hearty breakfast of oats, milk, and hay, Einstein would follow his mother out of their stall and into the paddock to explore. He had hooves the size of quarters. He would walk right under his mother's belly. Being so low to the ground, Einstein could see things up close, like the speckles of a tiger lily, his favorite flower. And children, this is a quarter. So this is the size of Einstein's little hoofs. In most ways, though, Einstein was like any other horse. He loved to gallop and hop, to sniff and trot, and lie in the warm sun. One day, while grazing in his pen, Einstein spotted a herd of miniature horses nearby. Their tails were shiny and whipped in the wind, and Einstein jumped with excitement, longing to join them. They dashed and darted. They zigzagged and sauntered. But as much as he might want to, the little colt just wasn't big enough to play with the other horses. When Einstein went to sleep that night, he dreamed of the day that he could run with the herd. There was no escaping it. Einstein was lonely. One afternoon, Einstein went in search of a friend. In the field, he came across a pair of kittens. He lowered his head to get a better look, and ouch, one of them swatted his muzzle. They meowed and hissed, scrambled and scurried. Einstein couldn't keep them straight as they wrestled with each other. Feeling a little dizzy, he continued on his way. Those crazy cats were definitely not the right playmates for him. Next, Einstein spotted some ducks by the pond. Quack, 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 they said loudly as they waddled off, clearly not interested in befriending a horse, even a little one. Maybe it was because he didn't know how to swim. Taking time out for a snack, Einstein noticed something in the grass. It looked like a rock, but then it began to move. All of a sudden, out poked a head. A tortoise! Einstein frisked in front of the gentle reptile, inviting it to play tag. The tortoise followed, ever so slowly. Einstein waited and waited some more, until finally the little stallion couldn't stand it any longer. This friend was boring. A bunny, basking in the golden glow of the afternoon sun, looked more promising. Eager to play, Einstein nudged it, but the sudden movement frightened the nervous rabbit. Einstein watched sadly as the bashful bunny hopped away. Poor Einstein. The animals he'd met were either too silly, too stuck up, too slow, or too shy. Why was it so difficult to find a friend? Maybe little stallions were just meant to be lonesome. He headed to the barn, where at least his mother would be waiting for him. Wait till you see who Einstein finds as a friend. Back by his pen, Einstein was in for a surprise. An odd-looking creature was poking through the fence. It was a dog with a snub nose, wrinkly eyes, and a head as big as the moon. She didn't have much of a tail, but what she did have was wiggling. Who does this look like? Who does that look like? Her name was Lily, like the speckled flower in the pasture. Slowly, carefully, Einstein scooted a little bit closer to investigate. The big dog opened her huge mouth and slurp, she gave him a big kiss. Einstein pranced from one side of the field to the other, showing Lily how fast he could gallop. Lily joined in, keeping pace perfectly. For the rest of the afternoon, the horse and the dog played tag. They rolled in the grass and loafed around together. It was as if they had known each other forever. The little horse with a big heart had finally found his friend. The next book that we're going to read is actually a fable. So you may have heard the story before. And the name of the story is The Lion and the Mouse, and the author is Jenny Broom. Once upon a time, there lived a great and mighty lion and a hungry little mouse. It was a hot day, and the lion lay sleeping under the sun, stretching out his paws, when up crept a little mouse. The little mouse looked at the berries hungrily. Above the sleeping lion was a bush bursting with the berries. A little mouse like me wouldn't wake a great and mighty lion, thought the mouse as she scurried across the lion's back and then down his leg and leaped into the air, reaching for a berry. Feeling a tickle, the mighty lion awoke with a roar and trapped the mouse beneath his paw. "I'm sorry," squeaked the little mouse. "I didn't mean to wake you. but the berries above your head looked so juicy, and I am so very hungry." The lion crouched down to look the little mouse in the eye. "I know what it feels like to be hungry," he said. And he helped the little mouse reach the juiciest berry on the bush. "Thank you," said the little mouse. "One day I shall be happy to help you in return." "Ha!" scoffed the lion proudly. "I can't imagine a mighty beast like me ever needing help from a little mouse like you." The little mouse just smiled and scampered away. That very night, two hunters walked into the jungle with a net that was big enough and strong enough to catch a lion. The hunters set their trap and slipped back into the darkness. Prowling through the jungle, the great and mighty lion was snared, that means caught, by the hunter's trap. He roared and roared, but he couldn't get free. Who could help him now? In the morning, the lion was woken by a nibbling noise. It was the little mouse who had heard the mighty lion's roar. She gnawed and gnawed until she set the lion free. The lion felt ashamed that he had laughed at the little mouse. "I was too proud to think that a little mouse like you could ever help a great and mighty lion like me, but I was wrong. Please forgive me," said the lion. And from that day on, the lion and the mouse were the best of friends. All right. So the craft that I thought we could do for this, for these two stories, were to create a lion and a mouse. So first of all, let's make the lion. And this is what you're going to end up with. So what I did was I just took an ordinary paper plate, and first I drew the face on with my black Sharpie. And first I drew the eyes, and I tried to make it look like the lion in the book. So I made his two eyes. And the nose kind of looks like a triangle, but with a rounded bottom. And then a lion or a cat's mouth kind of looks like that. So I started with that. And then I took my brown crayon and I colored all over the paper plate. And I won't take the time to do it all now, but I want to show you what I did. I colored the whole plate with my brown crayon. And then, to make the lion's mane, or the hair or fur that goes all around the lion's head, I took, and you can use any kind of pasta that you would like, I just took some curly macaroni or curly pasta, and with some glue, I just glued it all around the paper plate until I had finished the lion's mane. And what you end up with is a lion, just like the lion in our fable, the lion and the mouse. But the lion needed his friend, his best friend, the mouse. So to make my mouse, what I did is, this is what you're going to end up with. I took a plain white plastic spoon, and I took my black Sharpie and my red Sharpie, and I made the two eyes on my little mouse, with my black Sharpie. I made his two little eyes. And then with my red Sharpie, I made his little pink nose. And then again, I made his mouth that looks kind of like this. Make that a little bit darker for his nose. There you go. And then to make his ears, I used my quarter. And I traced two shapes, two circles, and I cut them out. And then in the middle of each circle, I made the center, which is kind of pink, in the middle of a mouse's ears. And you can just cut those out. And then with my tape, I taped it in the back. And what you end up with is your lion and your mouse. So as you read the story, you can kind of use these as puppets and tell the story of the lion and the mouse. And the last two books we're going to read today are Very Hairy Bear by Alice Schirtle and Waiting for Wings by Lois Ellert. Very Hairy Bear by Alice Schirtle. Deep in the green, gorgeous wood lives a bolder big bear with shaggy, raggy, brown bear hair everywhere except on his no-hair nose. Each spring, when the silver salmon leap into the air, Fisher Bear is there to catch them. He stands in the river with his brown coat dripping. A very hairy bear doesn't care that he's wet. Kerplunk! He'll even dunk his no-hair nose. In it goes when he smells fish. Each summer, he's a sticky, licky honey hunter with his bare nose deep in the hollow of a bee tree. A very hairy bear doesn't care about stings and things, even on his no-hair nose. When the summer blueberries grow round and fat on their bushes, a very hairy bear doesn't care that his nose gets blue. He eats berries and the bushes too. He's a very full, very full bear. In the fall, when quick gray squirrels hide acorns under the oak trees, a no-hair nose knows where to find them. A very hairy bear doesn't care if the squirrels scold. He eats all the acorns he can hold. Then, when soft white snowflakes start to fall and cling to the bear hair, if there's a bear there, you can hardly see him. When fish sink to sleep deep in the pond, wrapped in their silver scales, and swarms of bees sleep deep in their warm honey hives, and squirrels lay curled on heaps of nuts in hollow trees, he scratches his big brown bear behind on the roughest tree trunk he can find. An old big as a boulder bear crawls deep into his cave. He settles his big bear body down all covered up by his bearskin coat, all wrapped up in his big, hairy bearskin coat, except for his no-hair nose. A very hairy bear does care about ice-cold air on his no-hair nose, especially when he's sleepy. So, he puts his big, warm bear paws, his shaggy, raggy, very hairy bear paws, on top of his nose, and goes to sleep. And the last story that we're going to read today is Waiting for Wings. And this is a story about a butterfly waiting for its beautiful wings. Out in the field, eggs are hidden from view. Clinging to leaves with butterfly glue. Soon, caterpillars hatch. They creep and chew. Each one knows what it must do. Find a place where winds don't blow. Then make a case in which to grow. Caterpillar changes now begin. Body and wings take shape within. When it's time, each case is torn. Wings unfold, new butterflies are born. They pump their wings, get ready to fly. Then hungry butterflies head for the sky, looking for flowers with nectar to eat. They catch a whiff of something sweet. They follow the fragrant scent of perfume until they find our garden in bloom. We've been waiting for wings. We watch them circle, land on their feet, unroll their tongues, and begin to eat. They dip and sip. Then fly away back home to the fields. They have eggs to lay. And it starts all over again. Okay, children, to go along with these books, what I wanted to make with you is your own beautiful butterfly. And this was very easy to do. It didn't take many materials at all. I started with a black piece of construction paper, and what I did is I drew the shape of a butterfly. So you can take a crayon that you can see, and I used silver so that I could see it, and you just want to trace the shape. It's sort of a bunch of half circles, and you can trace around, make the shape of a butterfly, and then just cut that out. And after you cut it out, what I did was I just took some tissue paper that you probably have different colors around the house for wrapping presents. And what I did is I have my glue and I made a pattern. I made a design with the different colors. And I used three different colors. I used purple for the border, and I used pink, and I used orange. I'm going to show you how I did it. I saved a little bit to finish here with you. So you just take, I cut the tissue paper into small squares, and you can just scrunch it up like this, and take your white glue, put a dab of white glue on the black paper, and then just press this in, and it will stick. And you can make whatever colors you want. I'll do that one more time to finish off my butterfly. I've got a little black spot left right here. Just a little bit of white glue. Scrunch this up. Just scrunch it up and stick it on. And now my butterfly is finished, except for the antenna. And I took a black pipe cleaner, and you can make the antenna as long as you want. And I just turned it over, and with my clear tape, I made little bends in the top so it looks like a real antenna. And I just taped them in the back, and I end up with my own beautiful butterfly, ready to go sip the nectar.
Thank you, children, for sharing this time with me and helping me celebrate Winston's 9th birthday as we read the books that we read today about different kinds of animals. I hope you enjoyed the story, and I hope you enjoyed doing the crafts. So until I see you next time, remember, you can send me an email at storytimewithwinnyandnan@gmail.com and let me know if there's a book that you would like me to read or a craft that you would like us to do. So until I see you next time, bye-bye.